Hello and welcome to IR Thinker, where international affairs are discussed. I'm Martin Zupko. Today we're going to speak about interesting book, Rich Russians, with Elisabeth Schimpfössl. Elisabeth, welcome.
Hello.
Elisabeth is a senior lecturer in sociology and policy at Aston University. Her research focuses on elites and social inequality, as well as questions around post-socialist media and self-censorship. There is a professor from the University of Oxford, Catriona Kelly, who said about the book and Elisabeth the following words. Elisabeth Schimpfössl is a gifted observer and a sharp analyst. Rich Russians, based on unique access to the country's financial inner circle, dispels the myth around the Russian plutocracy and explores how today's rich emerge, often from the Soviet nomenklatura, to expose global neoliberalist values without wholly sacrificing the communitarian past. So we're going to speak about Rich Russians from a perspective of researcher. And it's a fascinating story, fascinating book. So Elisabeth, let's start with the first question, and it's about your motivation. So how did you initially become interested in Russian elites and the impact on the society?
Well, my book is from a perspective of a sociologist, and that I became only in my second undergraduate master's degree. First, I studied Russian and history, and then started working in development cooperation aligned to the foreign ministry in Austria. And at the same time, they just so not want no longer be a student. So I continued being a student, did sociology. What I was fascinated by in sociology were all these studies and theories around how social inequality, social class is being perpetuated over generations. Very important here, people like Pierre Bourdieu for France. And then I was thinking that there was a way to take these studies and apply them to Russia. At the time, it was when I started thinking about it, was 2005. And was discouraged from the idea by almost everybody. I was at Yale University at the time because the professors there thought that society in Russia was far too still in flux and transformation to apply any such theories and have them make sense. Plus, they told me I would never ever get access to anybody. Nobody would ever talk to me. And I thought, well, I'll give it a try, nevertheless. And so it came about. I didn't choose the rich from the start. I was looking at any possible social classes, and I wanted to definitely use my writing up here and do the PhD, not in 3 years, but four. It took me five in that. And I went to Manchester for that. And I was first thinking about the working class and then domestic violence, alcoholism, economic struggles, and I thought, well, that will have me end up depressed for 4 years, no good. Then I thought about the middle class, and luckily I didn't pick it. I would be defining what it is in the first place till now, probably wouldn't even have been 5 years, but 20. And so it came that I ended up with the rich, and also, but it was kind of a bit after years in this close to the Foreign Office Development Cooperation Organization, and I wanted to do it, was eager to do something that is good for nothing other than my intellectual enjoyment.
When you said that you studied Russian, does it mean that you studied Russian language or Russian culture or Russian politics? How was it?
Language and culture mostly.
And was it in Russia or in England?
Oh, that was in Vienna. I did my studies all in Vienna. I went to first to St. Petersburg for an exchange semester that was mostly just Russian, and then I studied in sociology and another exchange semester in Moscow at the RGGU, and that was with sociology students, which was interesting.
Absolutely. Let's speak a little bit about the access to those people, because this is sort of mysterious for everyone, how to get to those rich people. So I think, you know, when you wrote, as you said in various interviews and you know, commentaries, when you wrote to people through the Facebook or you call them, then what happened? Like, you know, I am a rich person in Russia and someone writes me or calls me. So what was the reaction and how was the development after that?
There were two projects then. The Winston book, the first one started in 2008. It was my PhD, and then a postdoc that started in 2015. And of course, this professor who said, nobody will ever talk to me, she had a point. She wasn't completely wrong. So what I did in my first project was I asked just anybody I knew or thought of who might have some link to someone who could help me further. That it then worked out, what worked out were not necessarily things I expected. I thought, for example, that many people who work in the wealth industry and some of them directly for oligarchs would be the most logical, hopefully also promising candidates. Wasn't the case. They often, I felt, did not want to waste their precious of when their limited times they can ask their big man for a favor. They didn't want to waste it on me, but so it was curious at the time. One thing that was bizarre was there was an Austrian journalist, correspondent for an Austrian newspaper, and he said at first he doesn't know anybody. Sorry, Elisabeth. And then he saw that I had already some success. And then he started trading with me in phone numbers. And back at the time, kind of seemed completely absurd and surreal now. You could get directly traded also rich people's phone numbers. And that was then, for example, leading to the interview with David Jakubashvili, who said, we could make a call. Out of blue, and some weren't particularly happy, but others were fine with it, and it worked out. Facebook, that was only, no, there were several in Facebook, actually, that's right. The first one, which I was quite impressed by, that was Ilya Segalovich. He is the co-founder of Yandex. He's no longer alive, died very young. And he replied to me, he'd be happy to give me an interview if it was for scholarship, but he would not like to give me one if it was for media purpose. In that case, I should approach the media department. And through him, then I also met his wife, and I came along a couple of times to, they run a charity for orphan children, and they had several events I joined.
You mentioned David Jakubashvili, who agreed to be interviewed, you know, and he got like $600 million from the transaction, so quite a rich guy. But on the other hand, also the manager, you know, not like real oligarchs. So my question would be why he agreed to be interviewed. Like, what was his motive to accept your invitation for an interview?
I have no idea. I was particularly surprised when I then went to the interview. It was a hot summer day, and one could easily get tired in the heat. And he must have been tired. He was not in a good mood. I was sweating and was sweating 3 times as much. He would give so short answers that I didn't even have a chance to take a sip or a cup of coffee. And it was decided, it didn't go well. And I thought, that's a grumpy fellow. But then met him again at the Economic Forum in St. Petersburg. And there he was the most charming person. And also when I agreed, what can I, the interview quotes, he was, well, certainly the interviewee with the best humor among all. Why he, I don't know. I can't tell. I've actually never even thought about that. I know some other person it was because I sounded so zabavna, how to translate it into English, so quirky.
Entertaining.
Yeah, bit funny. I mean, a bit funny in a not so a complimentary sense. Later on, it it became very, very structured. And you would never ever get in 2015 a phone number anymore. It would all run kind of very, very organized, and people had much more worked out also their PR strategies. In several cases, I think, like in the Sigalovich case, it was certain kind of a sense of obligation to scholarship and to support young people in their research.
I think it's interesting topic to elaborate on, because like if I were in his shoes, you know, I would say like, I just want to promote how good I am in a business, you know, to tell you how I made 10 millions here, 5 millions there, and to impress other people, you know. So that was my, you know, interest, you know, that I think it's always interesting to speak what's behind, what's the motivation behind. But also I noticed that you mostly skip the topic of business or politics, when interviewing people. Was this a security issue or the requirements coming from the oligarchs or rich people that they didn't want to speak about politics and you know, the business issues?
I can't even quite tell in the first project whether they might have actually been open about talking about politics. Some of them did by themselves. It was something two reasons. First, I thought it might be making things easier. And second, and more importantly, there are so many studies out there, people, investigative journalists, political scientists, who A, have worked through that, and B, it's exactly their topic. And I wanted to do specifically a sociological study because it did not exist from that time, and not even since, from the 90s. Was a little bit following in a way. Chrystia Freeland, I was very impressed by her book, States of the Century, even though she's not a sociologist, but a journalist. But I felt there was not anything that was continuing that story, and that was what I wanted to do. And not to mention, get often criticized that I wasn't doing an investigative study and look into how they made their money and by what means. But there are studies, Catherine Belton, wonderful book, I could never ever, it's kind of, it's not my task, let's say. So that was also interesting and different. So they did talk about politics in both periods quite a bit, but when they wanted to, in the way they wanted to. And there was an incident in the second one, a billionaire who started talking about, kind of complaining about the political situation. And I felt like, he is brave, speaking his mind. And he must have realized that just at the same moment and got a bit into panic and asked me whether that kind of would be anonymized. And I said, yeah. And we both felt he had stepped over a certain informal boundary, limits of what is allowed or not. And then I went home and listened to the recording and was quite surprised. Did actually not say anything all that dangerous or risky. He understood it rather as a kind of a risk he's taken by speaking his mind. Basically gone too far in a way. And in fact, it wasn't kind of any exciting, but it was obvious that in the situation, for both of the billionaire and for me, it was a danger zone we are now entering.
And you conducted around 80 interviews, right? So how long did it take?
The time lasted from half an hour to 5 hours.
Mm-hmm. And each time you flew to Russia, or was it also online?
Online? No, that was even in 2015 project. There was a kind of prior to the time, like in the olden days, the cassettes, the recorders, the floppy disks. No, that wouldn't have been done. There was only one single interview, if I'm not mistaken, that was on Zoom with a young person. But all the other ones were in person, either in Russia or in the West somewhere, and in St. Petersburg, a couple, and so on.
And mostly of them were in Russian or English, or how was
it? No, I insisted on Russian because they are speaking, it's their mother tongue. What's the point of two people are not English native speakers to speak in English when at least one of them can speak Russian? Of course, also they are doing the speaking, and it was also quite interesting to how exactly they express themselves. And everybody changes their identity slightly when speaking in another language, and that was the last thing I wanted.
Was there any typical first question that you ask, or how did you come to the first question, like the decision, what you're going to ask, how you're going to start the interview?
I was thinking about that and searching my memory, that's slightly failing me at times. I need to go back to that, and I can't remember. There must have been different questions and different times. I also tailored them. That's a very good question. I think in the first project it must have been something about how they see their role in society, maybe. I went then over to questions like what they think is what it was that it has been that made them so successful, about family-related questions, about broader questions of society, where society is going, about their children and what they wish to pass on that to their children, relationship to the West, and so on. The first interviews I also asked somewhere at the end, I don't know why I thought it was a good idea. Actually, it produced, I then felt awkward about it and stopped with shame because it produced quite interesting answers. I asked them about the use of maths, of swear words, and whether, because I find it fascinating I don't think, tell me if I'm wrong, that there's any other language that has something so specific, five basic words out of which you can make a whole language, and that is so hierarchical, beautiful, often perceived when used the top of the hierarchy, taboo for in between, and otherwise the language of the street.
Some people might be also interested in if you met any, let's say, thief in law, or in Russian, vor v zakonie, during the interviews, because you know that those was wild times in Russia. So, you know, my students and I think the international audience could be interested in.
I read a superbly interesting article today in quite long in Republic. There's a new book, and they had a summary of that. There were a few where I knew that. They've done things like trading in Duma, seeds, landmines in Africa, and stuff like that, but nothing of the sort anywhere close to Borussia as it developed during the Soviet Union.
During those 80 or more than 80 interviews, was there anything that you didn't expect and it completely surprised you in a way that you were like shocked?
I mean, in the first place, it was sometimes a bit odd how the very kind of, you know, like British upper class, always kind of out, seemingly super polite and friendly and inquisitive. They were not inquisitive at all. They're this kind of small talk, it's not what they need to do. And they could be quite arrogant. Those would be odd. There was this oligarch who in the car from a dinner party, and he was talking and his kind of things about civilization. He was kind of very engaged in and emotional about it. And then he would just drop down and be silent for a few moments. And I got quite worried and was wondering, heart attack or something of the sort. Then he came back, continued the sentence. There were others. And he was so the first project that also I didn't necessarily know. So some of the interviews were organized by middlemen, intermediaries, and something that was also some cases that I couldn't even know who the people were. They wouldn't tell me, I found it out later. And in such situations, I excluded many of them. And you asked before about the money. It's quite easy to get a certain feel of whether they actually fall in the money bracket I consider the minimum or not. And once you are in the wealth bracket, you don't talk about money. It's there anyway. When people talked about money, then it was rather that they went into lengths, elaborated on that money for them is something nevertheless vulgar, you need it, but it's time to move on and find something for the soul. So in this first period, when I ended up in interviews where I think clearly saw those are not actually candidates, there was one guy who had a studio, an art studio of Tverskaya, and a lot of kind of this aesthetic kind of tea ceremonies and monies and so on. And it was a round table with a bench, and he talked a lot about when he was facing bears in Siberia and moved it closer. We basically made the whole circle around the table in that movement, and then he demonstrated me his knife throwing skills. He had kind of the whole equipment there. That was bizarre. But in terms of who actually was suitable, in terms of topic, those billionaire's wife, when I asked what her parents had passed on to her that made her so successful, well, Elisabeth, genes, of course, genetic focus among many of them. What I loved was that it was a summer day again, morning, and an office where the sun was shining quite warm. And the guy could see he had some vodka the night before, and I was a bit sleepy as well. And he was talking a little bit bored about it himself and talking about his wife, who is having a career, and he quite annoyed about it because she should be actually spending more time with the children, and so kind of was getting tired and says all of a sudden that he was a sexist. Who called him? I'm a sexist. And that's an odd thing to say. And it was wide awake. And then he continued explaining to me that a sexist was not someone who loves sex. And then if he just told me that he was an atheist, if the Lord would have wanted men and women to be the same, he would have made them the same. But as he didn't, he had opposite points, and there's some responsibilities for women and others for men. And so it went. He then later on said, talked about gays. And he says, oh, I don't mind gays. I mean, I wouldn't have them anyway in my friend circles. But the men homosexuals are good, because the more homosexuals there are, the more women are left over for us. And so, yeah.
How did you feel when you were conducting those interviews? Because in the West, we were reading about the rich Russians. Some people met rich Russians in London or California or different countries, you know, but usually we were just reading, but you were speaking with them. So was there a special feeling for you as a researcher?
Interesting question. It didn't feel, I mean, I told you before the story about David Jakubashvili. I was sweating because of his monosyllabic replies. I wouldn't have thought about anything other than that. And there was a situation where where my brain didn't click who I was actually, in social situations, actually talking to. And then only in hindsight, things in place. I don't think I would have ever had time to reflect or think about such things. It was rather the bizarre stories when then afterwards coming out thinking, all those stats. That is so... I was ashamed when people often kind of assume that it's easier for women than for men. But of course, I had an advantage with was that I wasn't left foot the bill. And I mean, I had no money. 2008, before the crisis, was for me, was super expensive in Moscow. Funny, some billionaires, however, they were waiting for me to pay. But I know from some researchers, Vail, that their expenses were a little bit higher than mine. But then again, I missed out on all the sauna situations and you name it. Yeah, there were, however, funny stories. One person told me about there was a conflict going on in their some business partner, and they were going in two sort of the rivaling group to somewhere in Siberia. And the hotel, by default, if it's a men only group, organizes some girls for them in the sauna. And the first group of men basically didn't realize that the girls had ears and maybe a little bit of memory, and were talking freely. And then the next evening, the other group came and the girls passed on the information, and then the scandal broke. And nobody, you know, where was the leak? What happened? How was that information passed on?
So let's speak a little bit about methodology. You got data from those interviews, and then what? Like, what sort of methodology did you use, and what sort of challenges do you face?
What I did is the interviews. I also did a lot of, you can call them expert interviews. Most interesting ones were often actually by not the wealth industry people, but a courier, for example, and a builder I talked to, and taxi drivers, of course. And the third set of data was observations and social situations. And what I did was what you call thematic analysis, and for all the data, and tried to get my head around, basically. What I had to do that was a bit challenge. So there are two things. So the kind of like PhD student, you try to follow the rule, you don't even think that you might decide not to break the rule. Rules, and I should have, in hindsight, been much more flexible. So I had the idea that for an interview, it needs to be a formal situation where the interview partner had agreed on an interview, which I didn't realize that's so stupid, Elisabeth. You're losing so much data you could otherwise collect with your formalistic approach. And another thing that was stupid was that I didn't, right from the start, write enough typical ethnographic field notes, but relied on my recording. And it, what's a clear rule breaker was then in the analysis, even so I kind of, I thought it's true, I think it's stupid not to have the flexibility, when I used name and what I did when I anonymized people. And it was, of course, realizing that there's a big risk. Two things: a ridiculing interview narratives because it's easy and they basically presented it to me, and on the other hand, to self-censor. And in order to not self-censor, I used in the case of where people was expected to be named and expected to give permission for what they allow me to say their name, that I didn't dismiss the rest of the material, but gave them a fictional character. There was also a requirement from Oxford University Press. They hired a libel lawyer, and the libel lawyer said, anybody anonymized must not even recognize themselves. And if they recognize themselves, I said, why am I making them much more flattering them? He said, just not flatter them. On the contrary, be as blunt and honest as you can, because people are much less likely to realize that it could be them if they are not so wonderfully presented. A, B, if they even suspect it might be them, they are much less likely to cause fuss because they don't want to be identified, conflicted with this character.
Right. After publishing the book about Russia, no matter who you are, you usually are between two camps. The first one is respecting you for good work and for the research. The second is slightly suspicious of the links between the author and the Russia, some sort of pro-Russians, you know, narratives and stuff like that. So I'm sure that you receive feedbacks from both camps.
There was this one journalist who wrote a very, very long review. I don't know. It's not very well known, not very big. I couldn't read it to the end. It was too long and very complicated. But he found from the internet a photo. I was working for a few years as a volunteer at the St. Petersburg Ball in London. And there pictured, it's a kind of basically a fancy dress party, people in historical gear. And not a very, very flattering photo with me and sipping from a champagne glass. And this journalist said, obviously, I'm talking about, I'm not kind of going and exposing their dodgy businesses because I was bribed with champagne. And another bizarre situation was last year when, you remember in April, no, when was it? I think starting in April 2022, when people started falling from balconies. And I didn't, so there was this brilliant journalist, he must have been rubbing his hands. He did a story that was replicated all over the world in all languages, thousands of times, a list of about seven, what he called oligarchs, who died under suspicious circumstances, and looked them up in single names. Some of them were ruble oligarchs. Clever journalist, he was honest, but it got lost in the translation. And others were, they called oligarch everybody. We would never ever call them oligarch, certainly not before February 2022. One guy was from a kind of one part of Sibneftogaz from organizing and responsible for the internal transport system for this sub branch. The other one was an accountant, Buchhalter, oligarch. So it was kind of a very clever way that in order to get a lot of clickbait to a sensational story. And then I got a call from a CNN. They wanted me to field the program. And there was Phil Browder and another person already who said probably the Kremlin is not involved in him. And the journalist so wanted someone who said the opposite, and I explained, well, and there are certain hierarchies that restrict you to speak on your level. We see that Prigozhin was a bit going too far, thinking that Putin would right away talk to him. Would Putin ever make his hands dirty thinking about some Buchhalter accountant and his death? Unlikely, it's a bit beneath his level. And then on Twitter, I got accused by quite a few people of course, saying Putin's not involved because I must be on the Kremlin payroll. It's an interesting logic. What was interesting overall and how the book was received, I didn't mean to neither be, I want to just analyze them and sociologically and understand them. I didn't want to, it wasn't kind of my thing, it was my task to attack them, neither was my task to flatter them. It's kind of not the point. And the reception was by some that I was far too friendly to them, and by others that they came back to, oh, Elisabeth, one character worse than the other, and said, oh, that's not what I wanted either. Yeah, so it's quite interesting how broad the perception's been.
Developed, absolutely. I mean, it's a complicated topic, and you have views from different perspective, so there is almost nothing you can do. You just have to face to this and explain your position as a researcher. This is what you have to do. Let's speak about genes, because you mentioned that when you ask about money and wealth, some of them, they mention genes, like it's because of genes. I'm rich because of genes. So what does it mean in reality in connection to money?
It's an interesting thing, because once you say it's your biological structure, you're actually also implying that it wasn't your merits in a way, if you think it's wrong. It's not that they had thought it through, and nobody who says that has really kind of said that usually and thought things through. And, but it seemed like they were also aware of it, and they would bring in the meritocratic foundation of their success. It's by and large, however, was in most cases a mixture between genetic setup that just made them not necessarily more intelligent, that in any case guaranteed, more gifted, more talented, but also, and that was important, more entrepreneurial. So the entrepreneurialism is something you either have or not. Innovative, of course, hard, and then it comes to hardworking. But the other aspect that was very important was, which they gave a lot of credit to and were very grateful for, was their Soviet education, especially when they went to some special schools, wrong term, to some elite schools, often with books on maths and science.
In your book, you often mention charity and philanthropy. What does it mean, philanthropy or charity, for those rich Russians that you interview?
That was a question triggered. So the genetic thing, I didn't expect it came out from them, but I had a question specifically about philanthropy. And that was actually interesting. It was some of the questions I would have never expected to be any sensitive. And there were a few people who thought it was intrusive and also told me right away, they're not going to answer, it's a private thing. Once you talk about philanthropy, it's not philanthropy anymore. And so what we see in Russia in general is kind of social projects, charity projects, and philanthropy, like Blavatnik, but his beauty of arts with his Blavatnik Tower and Tate Modern. There were quite a number of, especially in the first project, throughout, who have these massive projects of setting up a new museum, which, of course, become quite surprising. It's not what's the point of setting up a new museum, it's all so established. For example, Boris Minsk with his Museum of Impressionism, Russian Impressionism, which he didn't kind of was there for long because he had to run off to London after his business bank went down. It was interesting to me to see what they talked about and what they saw, how they linked it, for example, to the idea of finding something new. Now they have money, but once you have money, you need to move on and do something beautiful and something that makes sense and for the soul. And for that, of course, philanthropy is ideal. Men are particularly engaged in art projects, which I found interesting. In the West, that's not necessarily the case. What is all over the world pretty much the same is that art philanthropy has much more prestige than social projects. Social projects in Russia are more on a female domain. And it's also something this men who were involved in it with their whole hearts, they were completely passionate about it. And it was basically their biggest thing. Not so good for those who haven't found place. And that was is kind of a problem for many. This unease when you come late, that a lot of areas have been taken. And you also kind of understand at some point, while you're not a specialist in any particular area, it's a bit kind of pathetic. There was a certain thing among those who hadn't kind of found this big, big passion project, that they had a certain kind of they were very open about it, almost something depressed about it from not having found their role for their own soul and in society, and especially if they'd left business operations because you need to grow out of it, and then a certain sense of maybe I'll be forgotten and will the world still need me as they used to. It's of course also philanthropy a thing for daughters to get involved in. And it's also something that, given the economic structure in Russia and these big oligarchic empires, that there's these foundations that deal with pretty much everything. In the UK, for example, philanthropists are much more specialized in the area.
How would you describe the role of women in rich Russian circles? Because I think the most you interviewed men. Am I correct?
That surprised me. I thought, oh, if I talk to someone, then it will be the ladies of leisure. And I realized then that the structure of society is so male-dominated that even when I went through social circles, the contacts I would get would be to men. I asked, of course, all of them, but I could talk to their wives, and I only got passed on to them if it was women who had to show something for themselves in also the eyes of the husband. So there were some husbands who were quite dismissive about, oh, does my wife work? She does something kind of design or so on. And then I wouldn't get the number.
Mm-hmm. And what about children? Rich Russian children and Russian society. What's your observation?
It's quite an interesting thing because in a situation, there's nowhere in the world, I would say, any such situation, we haven't had it in history, where such a concentrated class, China has many more, but Russia and China, they it's more, and they came up more continually, where so rich people, so compact group of this similar age group, come to an age state in their life where they have to think about what to do with their fortunes. And the next generation is coming in and is the first, obviously, such transfer of wealth to the next generation. And it doesn't make them particularly relaxed. It doesn't make them particularly relaxed either to think about setting up a dynasty, business dynasty. Not that they wouldn't want to, but it also would imply, it would only kind of in almost all cases be passed over to their sons, but it would also imply that they would have to do more than stick to their myth and wonderful legends of having done all by themselves and hard work and intelligence. Obviously, they would have to pass on their social contacts and also how to navigate them and not the things they've always told their sons that what their success is based on. And also it's a world that is, as you know, partly on the rough end of things, and it's not for all a desirable idea to see their sons be exposed to it. Of course, many of them, even though fathers always kind of wish that their children come back, and now no longer, last interviews I did to Russia, many of course do not. And when, from the children's perspective, it's a kind of a contradictory story. On the one hand, they could get quite open and say, then of course in the shadow of their parents, their fathers usually, and that they haven't it achieved anything that could compete, in no case, but kind of be worthy of what their fathers have achieved. And also that they are very, very aware they will never step out from under their father's shadow. And especially, not also daughters in relation to successful mothers in some cases, it's kind of something they feel is a burden. At the same time, very kind of clever in a way, there's also this idea of it's precisely because you were born in a family that has had good genes and this culture of success and meritocracy and intelligence that you by default are fast-tracked, not by your father who's made a phone call, but because you deserve it to be in the mid-20s in leading positions others reach if ever decades later in life. And some have elaborated on this, quite interesting. So, of course, I didn't have to do the things others had to do, let's say, because, well, on the one hand, it's the gifts, the talents they got by nature. But on the other hand, it's also what they were exposed to. From such a young age, there were all these interesting people coming to the house. There were all these interesting discussions. There were this kind of specific culture that by default gave them a head start in life in a positive sense that also makes it reasonable that they are further ahead than others of their age.
During your interviews, did you experience any generation gap? Because we know those hardcore oligarchs coming from the Yeltsin era and, you know, people who got rich by profession, by ideas, you know, the younger. So how was that during your interviews?
Not noticeable, and that also relates back to my title, From Oligarchs to Bourgeoisie, which is in some ways not quite correct, the title in terms of the oligarch term. If there's chance, I would say more about that. But in terms of the bourgeoisie term, it's certainly correct if we think, for example, of Putanin at the time in the late 2010s, he was a philanthropist in everybody's eye. Almost history repeating the robber barons in the late 19th century in the States, within only one generation kind of reinventing themselves as philanthropists. And if you think of it, Mellon, what are the names? Gosh, help me quickly. Rockefeller, and so on. They're talked about because of the libraries, the university endowments, their art centers, and so on, and not because of what they did prior to that. And the oligarchs are pretty successful in that. And I wouldn't say that the younger ones in the IT sector, maybe someone like, but it wasn't a generation, I mean, it was a very young Segalovich, but that is a different thing because it was this programming, mathematic skill sets that helped in the set of Yandex. But otherwise, they're not so, honest. You'd have to be made more specific for me to answer in what ways what the emphasis is in terms of generation gap. Think of that probably is one of the very, very few who actually only bumped into Putin several times by accident. But he's also just as unusual, not so much in that he used his brain, but in as much as that he was actually one of the few who made it from rich to find true. His father was a miner, so it was a proper manual working class background, and not like many others who. Again, an Arben, a Putanin, who were basically Soviet aristocracy in a certain way.
Do you understand oligarch as a terminology nowadays differently than during your interview times?
My understanding of oligarch is that of, for example, Jeffrey Winters, who political scientist, who would right away say, 2,000 years ago, Aristotle, the term oligarch, pretty simple, a rich man who uses part of the resources to defend their wealth. Oligarchs are not a question of whether the setting is authoritarian or democratic. In fact, if you look at America, a liberal democracy can easily have a lot of oligarchs. It's much more a question of wealth inequality in the country, and wealth inequality is the breeding ground for oligarchs to emerge, and then for them also to do whatever they can into lobbying, for example, to keep things that way and not have redistribution. And that we see in Russia just as much as the states, for example. And the Putin here is that it's precisely, so the idea of the criminologists are quite guilty of that. The idea of that oligarchs need to have captured the states, like it was the case in 1995 and the following few years, that they are running the state. Oligarchs don't want to run the state. They do it as a last resort when otherwise their wealth is at risk. But they much, much rather have other people do the job for them. Lobbyists, wealth managers, politicians, whoever. They're not keen on wasting their time on such risky ventures. So that means then for Russia also that it's pretty tricky to draw the line of who the oligarch is among especially rich people and who not. And that's the funny thing that when the sanctions started, individual sanctions from February onwards, all of a sudden, before oligarchs was maybe used by the Daily Mail, when it was kind of clickbait, the Russian oligarch with Swarovski ornamented car wasn't oligarch, that's seven. Maybe wouldn't quite meet the wealth brackets and political links that I implied. But from February onwards, suddenly everybody was an oligarch. And that, I think there was a kind of maybe a subconscious. Maybe it's not subconscious, very clever intention in that, because there was obviously, especially in the UK, not such a big desire to cut in their own arms, what is just saying, to hurt them, the politicians here and those who benefit from Russian money, to cut the links, and therefore, because people wanted oligarchs to be sanctioned, calling oligarchs who are no oligarchs. Or, for example, the CNN, even the CNN, calling an oligarch when falling from the balcony because it makes a better story.
Do you think that the Western scholars are able to understand Russian oligarchs in terms of research? And is there any community of Western scholars researching Russian elites? Because you are quite a unique case, and your book is quite unique. So I'm just asking for my students and viewers how is this topic worldwide?
There's very interesting research on elites globally. This tradition of scholarship, which is relatively new in this energetic form, maybe 15 years max, that looks precisely at rich people in the context of inequality, economic inequality. But there is still a tradition of, even among those scholars, and even so, for example, Thomas Piketty has repeated many times criticized the idea of calling an oligarch a Russian, maybe a Chinese, maybe an African, and when it's a Western rich man, it's an employment, workplace creator, philanthropist, an IT genius, and so on. And that is also reflected in this otherwise very, very progressive tradition of scholarship into elites and inequality. Whenever it comes to comparative research, Russia is by default to be compared to Gulf states, elites, to Indian elites, to Chinese elites, and so on. And I think that does not make any sense. We're losing out on so much if we get stuck in this, what I consider obsolete idea. In particular, if we look at the data, for example, that I've collected, something like being so sure that it's talent that makes oneself successful is actually not so much that many rich in the West wouldn't think the same. It's more that the super rich in the West have long learned it's not so good PR, I better not say it. They do admit to it in many other situations, or if their Boris Johnson just blurb out, right? So my argument is that as unabashed, as open, as freely Russian rich can be, it actually tells us a lot also of and about rich in the West.
The last question for today's interview. We know the book and we can buy the book to read about what you wrote in the book and how this book can benefit, you know, like, because I think it can help many students and the international audience to better understand the Russian oligarchs. But in terms of research, what this project gave you actually as a researcher? Do you understand Russian elites much better now?
Remember what I said at the beginning? I wanted to do, a bit childishly, a project that was good for nothing. I think for many, many years, there were many people who thought the same. It has changed with the war. And I find now most intriguing something that I want to follow up, how precisely the Russian elites, the Russian rich, are intertwined with Western rich, Western establishments as well. And it's quite a curious thing if we look, for example, a couple of examples, and Daria Zhukova, Dasha Zhukova, Abramovich's ex-wife. There was a wonderful investigation done by a New York Times journalist into her story. Turns out that because of what she represents, she is completely let off any link to Russian money. To consider, she has one child or two children with Abramovich. They still run the art center garage in Moscow together. Abramovich, turned out, it was had very cleverly organized his wealth, the trust money, and the assets that were not yet safely stored offshore. And I think it was 2 weeks before the invasion, organized them and passed them on to their children. Billionaires, but prematurely, not quite as planned. So there's a certain kind of link between Dasha Zhukova and her ex-husband was in terms of money. And yet the high society in New York are completely defending her. And Anna Wintour, for example, what did she say? I think she was who said, well, she's a good sign because she had a post, an anti-war post early on Instagram, I think it was. The director of the Metropolitan Museum of Art said that because she's the ex-wife of Abramovich and married to a non-Russian, she can't have any link to Russian money and so on. So it's basically the Western high society that does the PR work for someone like Dasha Zhukova. And she's, of course, eligible because of all what she represents, what she is, the philanthropic money she gives away, her beautiful accent, her beauty, her manners and everything. And I think that might be playing a role for the children of oligarchs in the next few years in other families too. One other story, what I find fascinating, the richest man on the Forbes list Russia, published in April 2022, so after the start of the war, was Vladimir Lisin. Vladimir Lisin is not on a single major sanction list in the West. He makes his money, he's got a steel empire that produces basic material right for the weapon industry, so right to the war. He's got good contacts into the nuclear sector in Russia, and he makes big money in Europe as before, and is completely forgotten. No sanction list, no media about him. And this year we have the richest. They did pretty well in the first year. Melnichenko is now leading the list. He had, on the previous year, he had 11 billion. Now he has 24, 25. And he's kind of completely not happy. That why should he be on this sanction list? And he's very good in his campaigning, not yet successful. But it will be interesting to see what will happen next on the front.
So thank you very much for your insightful thoughts and very interesting stories about your book. I think your book is very unique and I would recommend people to read it. Good luck with your research. And according to your words, I think there is a lot of to research. So thank you again. Good luck and see you next time.
Thank you.